welcome to John Horman, our former music director. Our beloved music director. We're so grateful that you are with us, John, for all the gifts and love and humor that you bring to us every time you're with us. Good morning, First Church. My name is Sam McFerrin. I'm the associate minister here, and I have the privilege to welcome you here on this final Sunday in June on Pride Month, and I have the privilege to welcome you here while our wonderful senior minister is on vacation, and we look forward to seeing Reverend Amanda Handler-Voss next Sunday. And this Sunday will be very special because not only do we have John Horman as our helping out with music, we have Reverend Sydney Avent providing the message for us today, who is a beloved member of our church, and we have Eric and Robin Olson sharing their musical gifts with us too. So we are a community of many, many gifted individuals, and we're able to share those today. And this Sunday, during the service, I'd like each and every one of you to reflect and dwell upon our summer theme, sowing the seeds of healing and wholeness. Life is often challenging, and when we experience these challenges, when we go through difficult times, one of the first things we need to do is that within us, God has planted a seed of accompaniment, showing us that things will get better as we heal, as we work towards wholeness. And it is in recognizing these seeds that God has planted in us and in us as a community that we are able to foster the courage to move forward, to overcome these challenges, whether it's disappointment or grief, anxiety or uncertainty. So during this service, I invite you to quietly reflect, especially during the times of music, where in life you recognize a seed of healing and wholeness helping you on your journey with God, with yourself, and with the communities that you're a part of. And I think by doing that, we come closer to God, and we, as a vessel of God, as a community, do a better job in figuring out who we're called to be. So I am grateful to each and every one of you here, and now I invite you to rise, if you are able, as we sing the opening hymn, Come, O Font of Every Blessing.
Good morning, church. I think it's safe to say that it's a truism that our nation is deeply divided on political questions, on cultural questions, on a whole lot of stuff. I feel it. We all feel it. And we experience these divisions in different parts of our lives. Maybe it's in what we read in the news, what we see on social media, what we deal with at work. For some of us in this congregation, we may feel like we're insulated in this beltway bubble and the divisions are between us and people out in other parts of the country. But for some of these divisions run right through our friend groups or even our own families. And I think it's easy to think that we come to church to be nurtured and supported in how we get through a world that is so polarized. That's part of it, that's important. And it's easy to think that our values are God's values and that we're here in this congregation because we want to put into practice in our lives Christ's message and ministry of social justice, radical welcome, and unconditional love. But there are points where Jesus' message is not all that warm and nurturing to us. He actually tells us in some places that polarization is inevitable and that, and here's a quote, one's enemies will be the members of one's own household. And I've thought a lot about that passage over the years because it speaks personally to me. And sometimes it sounds to me like, well, that's, you know, sometimes relationships, you just kind of got to let them go. But there's this place in the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus also says, love your enemies. And if our enemies can be members of our own household and we're to love our enemies, I think there's something important there. And it's something important maybe for us as a nation. This is one of God's values, to love the people on the other side of our polarized debates. I don't know how to do that. And in the spirit of, as Sam reminded us, our summer theme, sowing the seeds of healing and wholeness, there's a lot that we could learn about that. I'm not the preacher this morning. Reverend Sidney has some words for us, and I don't want to step on her toes. But I've increasingly been thinking, I want to come to church to listen for the seeds that help me learn to love enemy. I don't know what that love is necessarily. I may have a lot to learn there. I may have a lot to learn about what an enemy is, but I think there's something there that we can come to church to specifically listen for and to look for. So in that spirit, I suggest that we now let us worship together.
Okay. Thank you, Andrew. And now I'm going to invite my son, Brendan, who's a very good sport, to join me for the children's moment. So thank you, Brendan. All right. So Brendan, here we have a lot of things here, and we're going to talk about a few things, and hopefully everyone can see me. So in Mark 4, Jesus teaches us a parable, and a parable is a lesson. And he has, it's called the parable of the sower. So, Brendan, I'm going to give you these seeds, okay? And Jesus teaches us where the best seeds are to grow. And he has all these analogies. And the first analogy is he threw the seed on hard ground. Then you just drop it, and what's going to happen? And it, guess what? The birds ate it. The birds came up and they ate the seeds, and they were no fertile ground. And then the second way is they threw it among some weeds, and the seed didn't do very well either. And the third way is it was threw the seed among some rocks and some sticks, and the seeds didn't do very well either. And then finally, Jesus scattered the seed into fertile ground, and that is where we place our faith. The fertile ground being God's love for each of us, and that's how we grow in God's love on our journey. And as many of you know, 2 weeks ago I was in Montgomery, Alabama. And this fertile ground and this dirt reminds me of how God holds on to us as we recognize the hardship of some of our history together. So in Montgomery, Alabama is the Equal Justice Initiative, which is an extraordinary nonprofit organization that was first dedicated to helping defend those who were on death row. And since then has become a worldwide organization for healing and reconciliation, especially as it tells the human stories of the transatlantic slave trade, the domestic slave trade, and lynching and Jim Crow. And there are three, there's a museum, and then there's the sculpture garden, and then there's a national monument, and you experience the stories and the power of it. And one of the most powerful things that I saw is embodied here. And this is dirt from my backyard. And when I think about this dirt, I think about all the good times and all the challenging times that we have had in my backyard. But at the Legacy Museum, there are shelves and shelves of much bigger glass containers of dirt. And on each glass container is written the county and the date that individuals were lynched in our country. And seeing the date and seeing the names of the people was heartbreaking. And what EJI, Equal Justice Initiative, has done is that they've invited communities where lynching has occurred to have a ceremony in their community to get dirt from where that occurred, to honor those humans that died, and to plant seeds for reconciliation and healing on the way forward. And the closest ones to us are in Alexandria, where there were, where there are two teenagers, Thomas McCoy and Benjamin Thomas, who died in Alexandria in the late 19th century. And they had a memorial service there in the heart of Alexandria, and they brought the dirt there. And God is speaking to us, not only in the present, but as we remind ourselves of our history. And it is through reminding ourselves of our history and the humanity of our history that we can fully become the people that God wants us to be. So I'm grateful that we are honoring those enslaved laborers who worked on this land here through our art representation. I know we had a great conversation about that a couple weeks ago, but I think I encourage you to get some dirt and from your backyard and to think both about the times of joy but also the times of hardship. And there's something really healing about touching dirt, right? You feel really, there's a sense of connection there that you really can't have elsewhere. And I think it's that connection to the ground that reminds us of our connection to one another. So God calls us to plant seeds, thank you, Brendan, for healing and for wholeness. So let us pray. My man. Loving God, hold on to us. As you remember all those who went before us, who call us to be your servants. In love. Amen. And now I invite us to rise and share the peace of Christ with one another. Peace, Reverend Avent. Thank you so much. Yeah.
on my journey through this strange and foreign land. Be my guiding North Star through the night. I am a weary pilgrim. I could use a helping hand. Tell me everything will be all right. On my way home when I'm lonely, on my way home when I'm so scared, on my way home when it's only you who truly care. 'Cause you have brought me thus far, I know you will not leave me now. Oh, help me on my journey to get home.
Help me help some others who are struggling more than I. Open up my heart to let them in.
When there's weeping in the midnight, may the morning dry their eyes.
Shine and let your healing grace begin.
On our way home when we're hurting, on our way home when we're so blue, on our way home make us certain that you will see us through.
'Cause you have brought us thus far, we know you will not leave us here. So help us on our journey to get home.
Help me, brother. Searching on my way home without a clue. On my way home when I'm turning more and more to you. 'Cause you have brought me thus far, I know you will not leave me now. Help me on my journey to get home. Help me, help me, help me, help me.
Read responsively with me this reading adapted from Psalm 30. I will extol you, O God, for you have raised me up. O God, my God, I cried to you for help. O God, you released my soul from despair. Sing praises to God, O faithful ones. For God's anger is but for a moment. God's favor is for a lifetime.
Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes in the morning.
As for me, I shall never be moved. Hear, O God, and be gracious to me.
God, be my helper.
You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have taken off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy.
Now I am
Today's scripture reading is Mark chapter 5, verses 21 through 43. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came and when he saw Jesus, fell at his feet and begged repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So Jesus went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And the disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say who touched me?" Jesus looked around to see who had done it, but the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him and told him the whole truth. Jesus said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When Jesus had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha cum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat.
Morning. I love coming to church, and I love coming to church here. It is so wonderful to see how God is moving here and how, without our coordination, the pieces are beginning to fall together. And Sam has told you that our theme is sowing the seeds of healing and in wholeness. I'd like to add to that phrase, in community. And First Church is a community. Now, some of you know that I was a lawyer in my former life, and given the things that have been said and sung this morning, I feel like I could just close and rest my case. That the seeds have been sown. They are in our hearts and in our spirits. But I will try to add to what has already eloquently been stated here this morning. And when I say what has been stated here, and while I'm saying this morning, I really would like to talk about the last 24 hours, because there are some of you who I saw at 6:30 yesterday morning, and I'd like to recognize that this is a community that knows no limits in terms of our outreach to our siblings, wherever they are. So Sandy, thank you, and all of your co-laborers who were here providing an extravagant welcome and gracious hospitality to part of the community that participated in yesterday's march on behalf of the Poor People's Campaign. I want to thank Reverend Amanda in her absence for once again entrusting me with the responsibility and the opportunity to share with you a word from the Gospel of Mark. Thank you, Dwan, for your beautiful reading of today's text, and Lucille for leading the responsive reading from the Psaltery this morning. And then Robin and Eric, how did I know? Why didn't I know that you too were so wonderfully talented? A trombone on Sunday morning? That's delightful. I happen to like New Orleans jazz, so I was pleased to see the instrument on the stand when I came in this morning. Let us pray. God, we come humbly to you this morning, letting our intentions be known to you, and praying that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts will be acceptable in your sight and in your hearing. For you alone are our rock, and you alone are our Redeemer. Amen. The Gospel of Mark seeks to illustrate and to inform us as to who Jesus was and the source of his authority. Mark contains 17 miracles, or as they're referred to later in the gospel, 17 mighty acts of power. They include exorcisms, healings, and power over nature. Today's text includes stories of two miracles. The structure of the text is unique. It is, in fact, a story within a story, ultimately producing wholeness through miracles or mighty acts of power. Mark uses this sandwiched structure or literary device to show the relatedness of the two stories. The healing stories at first blush seem dissimilar, but a closer look shows several parallels. Each story centers an unnamed female. One person is 12 years old. The other has suffered from an illness of blood, presumably hemorrhaging, for 12 years. One is the daughter of a privileged leader of the synagogue, and while the other presents now as a person without means or alternatives, we know that at one point she had the access and money sufficient to visit many doctors over a 12-year period. Crowds or community were present either before or at the time of the healing acts. Each person was considered ritually unclean. For the girl, it was because she was presumed dead. And for the woman, it was because of her bleeding. Jesus was not deterred by the ritual uncleanliness of either and without hesitation, he knowingly subverted Jewish norms and rituals by placing himself in close proximity to each of them. And finally, each story ends the way it began, incomplete. What do we know about the metaphorical seeds of healing and wholeness in each story? What we know is those seeds were seeds of faith. The faith of a woman who had heard about Jesus. Faith that if she just touched his garment, not touch him, just simply his garment, that she would be healed. And the faith of a father who believed in the healing power of the laying on of hands by Jesus. We don't know what the 12-year-old girl did after she rose from the bed, walked, and ate. We don't know what the woman with the issue of blood did after her chronic illness was no more and her strength was restored. Perhaps they chose, like the two people I'm about to tell you about, perhaps they chose to stay in community and allow the blessings of love to flow to and from them. I'd like to share two stories of healing with you, stories that could arguably illustrate the sowing of metaphorical seeds of faith. I was recently in Istanbul, Turkey, with a group of clergy and seminarians, and had an opportunity to meet many activists who, in addition to their efforts to change societal norms, were experiencing their own personal transformations, including their own healings. One person we met was inspired by the civil disobedience uprising at Gezi Park. The Gezi Park uprising was created and navigated by a coalition or community of LGBTQ persons, environmentalists, and Muslim feminists in the spring and summer of 2013. What an unlikely coalition, at least from our American perspective. The person we met was inspired to join the movement, and in the process, was inspired to begin their own healing and transformation, a process during which they became whole. They owned their queerness and channeled their education and gifts into a nonprofit organization which provides myriad services to the LGBTQ community. It was in community that they found their individual healing and identity. It was in community that they learned lessons and acquired data through their service delivery model, which informed their advocacy and strategies for communal healing. The individual healing and communal healing was synergistic. Another person we engaged was a young woman who was reared in a traditional Muslim home with a father whose ultimate goal was that all five of his children would memorize the entire Quran. Consistent with this fealty toward the Quran, the young woman was required to wear modest traditional clothing, including a hijab. She married young, trading control by her father with that of her husband. At a point, she determined that she would leave the marriage and pursue a college education. When we met her, she was dressed modestly, but not traditionally. Like students in the US, she wore a nondescript loose outfit consisting of a shirt, pants, and a jacket with no hijab. Her hair was cut short and discreetly colored at the nape of her neck in blue and red, in a manner that was only noticeable if you saw her from the side profile or directly from the back, but not from the front. She acknowledged that her severe financial struggles and the mental and emotional stress of her forced isolation from her family caused her to question whether there was a God. Yet she also acknowledged that she continued to pray in response to the daily 5 calls to prayer. The seeds of her faith and identity persisted. She began her healing transformation process alone, in isolation, while living with her husband. But she progressed to identify and join her current community, those who nurture her intellectual curiosity, encourage her seeking of personal growth, and support her physical and emotional healing. Her community also includes those who she is mentoring along a similar path. She continues to become, with the context of a new community of healing. In today's text and in these stories of two individuals I recently met, the seeds of healing and transformation were metaphorical. I would like to share one story with you in which the seeds were and are material, tangible, physical. Vivian Sansour is an artist, researcher, writer, and founder of the Palestinian Heirloom Seed Library. She speaks of the way in which seeds hold the hope and stories of her people amidst atrocities. In an episode of Prentice Hempel's podcast, Becoming the People, Sansour recounted the story of a young man who returned to the location in Gaza where his former home was obliterated, and where he found dried peppers, remnants of the peppers he had once planted. Peppers are a staple in the Palestinian diet. Notwithstanding the fact that he lost his home, he was happy to harvest seeds from the dried peppers and plant them in a patch of soil he hoped would be sufficient for the nourishment of new pepper plants. Sansour offered that by its own being, a seed reminds us that two things can exist at the same time, death and life. A seed is both the beginning and the end. Sansour goes on to speak of her organization's efforts to get people all over the world to sow and grow Palestinian heirloom seeds. She opines that these seeds contain Palestinian stories in their DNA, the stories of people who originally planted and harvested the seeds, the culture and the recipes of the people who cooked and ate the produce. Not unlike the rice stories of the enslaved West Africans who transferred rice seeds, transferred cultivated skills, and transferred cultural practices necessary for establishing rice in America. Perhaps the Palestinian pepper seeds will help sustain the history, the hope, and the culture of the Palestinian diaspora. In community, the fruit of metaphorical and literal seeds can be healing for wellness and wholeness. In community, seeds contain the hope of a people. In community, seeds are the beginning and the end. But what is healing? What is wellness? Perhaps as Reverend Dr. Shaniqua Walker Bonds has shared relative to her own journey with chronic illness, sometimes wellness looks like learning to be sick, to stop fighting our bodies, to accept our limits, and to recognize and advocate for our needs, learning to be well in a different way. Perhaps the first healing of the woman with the issue of blood occurred when she recognized the severity of her condition and advocated from doctor to doctor, and finally through her touch of Jesus for her ultimate healing. And what is wholeness? Perhaps it is not a destination, but instead is a God-informed, a God-led process. Perhaps it is a dynamic, not a static process of becoming, a process of transformation. As we become whole, as we are transformed, we are reminded of Psalm 23 with the words, "And surely goodness shall follow me all the days of my life." A better translation of that phrase is, "Surely God will pursue us with goodness and mercy." God is not content to wait for the psalmist or for us to decide to come to God. God will pursue us every day, and we will be transformed. We will be changed. There are synergistic effects of healing in community. It is in community that the metaphorical seeds of love, compassion, healness, wellness, identity, hope, and wholeness are sown. These seeds pass through or cross permeable yet invisible boundaries that physically separate but do not isolate us from each other and from nature. In community, these metaphorical seeds are watered and eventually bloom. Given the stories we've shared today, we may ask, can there be a truly complete healing alone, in isolation, without community? Know that we are never alone, because God is with us. The people whose stories we shared, their healings, their becomings are not singular. Yes, their individual stories are fine exemplars, but it is in community the individuals found their new identity, their resurrection, their resurrected lives. It is in community that it is most evident that these individuals are, as Reverend Dr. Eric Thomas would say, that they are the luminous projections of the image of God. It is community that we can, that we must, light the paths for others, reflecting for others that they too are luminous projections of the image of God. And as they do, they will continue to become all that God foreknew. Humbling circumstances, the loss of status, of self, of family, of community, and of life. The stories within the stories. But God. But the resurrection, lives made new in community, world without end. May it be so. Amen.
As a downtown church, we take great pride in being able to provide extravagant hospitality to everyone who enters our doors. So grateful to Sandy and everyone from the UCC, as Reverend Sidney lifted up, that we're able to provide that hospitality to the Poor People's Campaign yesterday. Some may call it radical hospitality, but I think it's just honoring the UCC mantra: wherever you are on your journey, you are welcome here. And God calls us to lean into our faith to create a belonging and welcome for everyone. So for today's offering, we want to lift up our hospitality coordinators. We have two extraordinary coordinators, Kamisha Thomas, who is with us today, and Michael Thompson. They're amazing young adults who provide support, warmth, and compassion to those members of our community who may need a little extra love and help. They may be facing challenges that include food insecurity or housing or just a space for warmth and friendship. And because of this, of our faith and our community here, Kamisha and Michael are the extensions of this hospitality for us. And they are our welcome ambassadors, and they help us live out this welcome. So in honor of that, I want to thank Kamisha and Michael, and I want to thank the church for recognizing how important Kamisha and Michael are to us. So in that spirit, let us take up the offering. The easiest way to honor the offering is you can provide a donation in the plate before you leave the sanctuary. You can also support us online by going to our website, and you can pay via PayPal or Venmo. But the seeds of hospitality are in our hearts, and in that spirit, let us rise and sing the doxology.
I'd like to celebrate the life and bless the memory of Kathy Wolf, who is a former member of this church.
I guess I have to, speak to how painful Thursday night was. And, and how I don't know what to do. And I can just hope that the process of the next few months will result in what I certainly want. It's just sort of, what do we do individually? It's very hard. That's it. I just wanted to give voice to that. It's already been, spoken to, but it was hard. It is hard.
I share that. We all do, I think. I want to ask for prayers for my two neighbors, Mark and Mike. Mike's mother died, and 3 days later, Mark's sister died. And, you know, it's a lot of loss for these two wonderful men. And I just want to pray that they find healing with their families during this period.
I just want to again say how glad that our family was to go to the Poor People's Campaign yesterday. I was really, we've gone many times, but I was really struck by just these 1 minute speeches by these people from just all walks of life and what they deal with and what as a community we are responsible for.
I did want to speak to some powerful moments, I share the fear and the angst and the anguish about where we are in this world, and especially after Thursday. But what gives me hope is that that's not the whole story. And being down at the Poor People's Campaign reminded me that that were the other part of the story. And there was a moment when, at the very end of the rally, where they had a literal casket, and it was to represent all the people who have died from poverty, who many whose names we may never ever know, so we often lift up people that we know who've passed. And it was a powerful moment to lift up people who died from poverty, and we often think of people dying from poverty. And then after that, there was a moment of prayer, and a Palestinian activist leader and a rabbi prayed for each other's people. It was really powerful.
Thank you all.
I'll just lift up my uncle Thomas Johnson, who died 2 weeks ago. I was fortunate to go up to Connecticut for a quick 24-hour trip to be at the funeral and the burial, which was really meaningful, and to be with some family I haven't seen in a while. So just prayers for him. And he was a wonderful man, and his wife died in 2015, and he missed her dearly, and so I'm comforted that they are now together.
God, we call upon you to hold all of us who are grieving, and these include Meg's neighbors and those grieving, Laura's uncle, my uncle, and others. We also thank you, God, for the connections, and that we are all connected to one another and to you, and through these connections, we can see each other more fully and clearly and act for justice. Reverend Barbara was in Montgomery, Alabama, just a few months before yesterday, at the church that hosted us for a potluck, and he was there to provide encouragement to the workers at the local Kia auto plant. So those connections kind of remind us that even though we're here at one corner of a street, we are not alone in the call for justice. So let us pray. Loving God, today we return to you for your steadfast love, for the well of strength that only you can provide us, and for your ability to truly listen and understand us when we are afraid or the path in front of us is unclear. Please continue to sow in us and in our communities the seeds of wholeness and healing, so that we can more freely love one another, to stand up for justice, and answer your call to be your people. We think of places today like Gaza and Ukraine, where innocent people are put in harm's way. We think of places like here in the United States, where a rhetoric of white nationalist pride and fear-mongering continues to blind us from seeing one another fully. and creating beloved community. We call upon each other to work for economy, an economy that works for everybody and is not just based upon profit margins. It is based on people thriving. Our heart breaks as we hear about more and more people facing food insecurity, more people across the country losing their homes, more children finding trouble, not knowing where the next meal might come from. To paraphrase the prophet Isaiah, prepare the way, O God, where through the seeds of wholeness and healing should come strong oak trees of community and blessing, a forest of community builders and compassion givers, seeds where boys and girls and siblings feel loved and can thrive, for we are all called to help create your kingdom, where every valley of doubt or despair shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill of challenge to be brought low, where the crooked places shall be made straight and the rough places made smooth. And to this, O God, we say amen, amen, amen. And in one voice, let us share the prayer that Jesus taught us to say, saying, Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now I invite you to rise, if you're able, to sing the closing hymn, Sent Forth by God's Blessing, which can be found at number 76 in your hymnal.
Thank you.
announcements. The first announcement is just great gratitude for everyone that made this morning so special. John, it's really such a treat to have you with us, and it's great to be with you, and thank you for your musical gifts. Reverend Sydney, your message about healing and wholeness and community really resonates so deeply with all of us, so thank you for that. And Lucille and Dwan, your scripture readings, and Andrew, your call to worship, and the Randy Newman duet of the Olson brothers was just a real joy. And Brendan, for helping me with the children's moment, so I appreciate you stepping up for that too. We are really blessed to have a community that pitches in. And thank you, Amelia and Tom, for helping with the sound, and Mike Hopkins for coffee hour. Immediately after the service, we'll have coffee hour. Also, on July 21st, we are going to the ballpark to root on our Nationals as they take on the Cincinnati Reds. We still have a few more tickets. If you'd like to join us, please let me know, send an email, or find me after worship, and I can share with you about that. Also, we are grateful that we were able to host the Poor People's Campaign. I just want to echo that again, because I think the National Church seeing us having that role is really significant, and about ways that we can embody welcome and justice for that. And now I invite the wonderful Reverend Sydney Avent to share the closing blessing for us. So thank you.
Please receive this blessing. Now to God, who by the power at work within us, within our community, who is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we can ask or imagine. To God be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever, world without end. Amen.